the invite to speak here. It's a pleasure. So, as the title slide indicates, I'd like to talk about research data and scholarly publications going from casual acquaintances to something more. And I'll start out by providing some background on why I'm here, even though I'm not a publisher, at least a card-carrying one. I direct the informatics program at a national research center by the name of NESINT, or National Evolutionary Synthesis Center. The aim of this is to bring together researchers from around the United States and the world to collaborate across institutional boundaries, across disciplinary boundaries, ways that can't really be funded by traditional mechanisms, to leverage existing data, ideas, and know-how. So putting elements that are already out there together to address research problems that are larger than the research program of any individual scientist. So what are the shared principles at work in the domestication of animals and plants? What role do the early atmosphere play in the slow increase in the sizes of organisms on the planet? How much should we be worried about independent origins of multiple drug resistance pathogens? Those kinds of questions. So this kind of collaborative approach to scholarship, which builds on vast stores of information and knowledge that have already been accrued for decades and in some cases centuries, is becoming rather commonplace. It's being driven by funding bodies. It's being driven by research institutions that are seeking to gain advantage in particular areas, by technological advances, and very much by the inability of any individual researcher to bring the entire meal to the table. So specialization is inescapable today, and we're all dependent on our colleagues to bring the dishes that we don't know how to cook. So it's not uncommon for someone doing a project at our center to catalog, say, every article that's been published over the last few decades on a certain topic, say, the strength of natural selection in wild populations, and then with the intent of doing a meta-analysis on that. Are there patterns that explain when we see more significant values than others, or when, under what conditions is selection more variable than others? So some of the information for this kind of meta-analysis is available in published articles. Much of it requires access to original data. The data is often reported in the article, it's used in the article, but it's generally not disclosed in the article, not very often. And it was never disclosed, in recent years, at least before the advent of supplementary online materials, and pretty rarely since. So our researcher will write lots of emails to authors of these earlier studies asking them to share their data, and a typical response rate, what would you predict? For us, somewhere around the area of 5%. That should say they eventually get the data for 5% of the studies. So if you're surprised by that, you shouldn't be, because there's considerable work in the literature that validates this across many disciplines. So a classic case is Wickertson et al. In psychology. In the American Psychological Association journals, authors have to sign a statement saying that they will share their data upon request, no questions asked. But when they actually requested data from all of the recent papers in the journal, 6 months later, after 400 emails, detailed descriptions of study aims, approvals of ethical committee, signed assurances, and full resumes, only 27% of authors complied. So researchers hold on to it for all the reasons that you might imagine. They hold on to it for competitive advantage, distrust of colleagues, frankly, worry of mistakes being found in their data. It's been suggested that researchers have a conflict of interest, in fact, and really shouldn't be asked to share the data on a case-by-case basis because it's too tempting to be bad. But surprisingly, surveys of researchers who admit to not sharing data reveal that the number one reason given is how difficult it is to provide the data after the fact. 80% of the cases, researchers say that's a contributing factor in the field of genetics, a nice study by Campbell's group. The sin of it is that if they were motivated to share, then when they're asked to do this 3, 5, 10 years later, the time window for that is gone. So the details of the study decay fairly quickly after the time of publication. People move on, people really move on, and the data's lost. So the kind of synthetic science that I was talking about is becoming very commonplace. The NSF in the United States has been launching synthesis centers like this at an increasing pace for the last few years. There's one in mathematical biology, there's one in plant science, there's one just announced in environmental science last month, and the scale of these is not insubstantial. So every year, over 1,000 or so scientists come through our doors to participate in these kinds of activities. So for that reason, the growing importance of this kind of science, and the reason that the unavailability of data simply calls into question the integrity of the published record, the absence of a significant piece of it is really a problem that needs to be addressed. And the role of technology in creating the problem in the first place is an interesting one. So back in the halcyon days, when journals didn't have such strict page limits, it wasn't uncommon to see more or less raw data published in articles. And so this is a classic case in our field of evolutionary biology. So in 1898, this fellow named Bumpus collected data on sparrows that had been knocked down by a storm in New England, and he published about 14 or 15 pages of raw data in tables in the manuscript. And we probably wouldn't be talking about Bumpus today if he hadn't done this, because this has become this classic data set that's been used over and over. There are all sorts of methodologies that have been developed using this as a test case to compare with the results of previous methods. It's been used in classrooms for a century now. Everyone in my field knows these data. But the limits of the printed page eventually led to wholly artificial customs of what belongs in an article and what doesn't. And data, most of the time, like this, didn't. So there was a time period when it was okay to publish raw data in one's paper, time period when that was no longer okay, a time period when supplementary materials allowed you to publish it, but the convention of doing this had been gone, had been lost. So the brilliant idea behind the scientific research article, which was invented a while back and not so very far away from here, is that the researcher claims priority and gets the glory for their findings, but at the same time, other researchers are free to verify their work and to build upon it. We don't vet who's allowed to read our articles. We don't require co-authorship if they use published ideas. People we violently disagree with are free to dispute our findings. If we deceive by omission or commission, then we break this social contract. And since everyone is dependent on the results of others, we suffer a loss in reputation and we suffer a loss in professional stature. So it's not an accident that modern science was born with the invention of this thing. And it's interesting, note that this in the 1600s is 2 centuries after the invention of the printing press. It wasn't the technological innovation that was the immediate cause of this, it was the social invention of that contract that I described. That's the immediate innovation that allowed science to thrive. And we take this for granted today. Most researchers never question the social contract. They publish with this in mind, just implicitly. And modern science is inseparable from this institution. But arbitrarily and unfortunately, this very productive social contract, for the kind of technological reasons that I just mentioned, is only applied to that which appears in the traditional article and has not been applied to data, although data is an equally valid research object on which you might wish to apply this contract. So a great illustration of that, which Michael Nielsen nicely tells about, the story of Galileo when he discovered the rings of Saturn through his telescope. He wrote up the finding. He conveyed that to savants who would appreciate his finding. But he did an interesting thing. He wrote up that finding in code, and he did not reveal the code. So if someone later were to say, oh, I found the rings of Saturn, he could say, no. I've got this code. Unseal that envelope, decode the message, you'll see that I have priority. This was what scientists did before the invention of the scientific article. So today, with data, scientists are kind of like Galileo, right? We say, here is my article. It describes all this wonderful data collection that I've done. Boy, is it something. Here's all the stuff I was able to milk out of it. Here is the significance of it. But you want to use it? Well, I don't know. So what do you want to do with it? Do you want to make me a co-author? Are you a big cheese in the field who I want to butter up? Are you some graduate student I could ignore? What can I get out of sharing this data with you? Right. So there's this great divide between what we do with articles and what we do with data. And there's not really a sensible set of reasons why that's the case. So, how am I doing? So here we are at the state of affairs today. Some of you may have seen these data from the Publishing Research Consortium published a couple years ago. a survey of thousands of researchers across the world from many different disciplines, asking them, what are the most important research objects to you? Which ones can you easily access? And it's good to see that research articles are up here in the top right. They're highly important, and they're easy to access. Where you don't want to be is in the lower right-hand corner with data sets, data models, algorithms, programs. They're ranked as quite important. They're also ranked as not very accessible. And everyone seems to agree that that's something to be fixed. So STM, Brussels Declaration in 2007, raw research data should be made freely available to all researchers. Publishers encourage the public posting of raw data outputs of research. Sets or subsets of data submitted with a paper to a journal should, wherever be possible, made freely accessible to other scholars. So articles are offering this veneer of reproducibility. Everyone seems to agree on how to improve it, but there isn't really substance to that reproducibility. And since we're close to Oxford here, I can't resist another analogy. So the Mad Tea Party. Have some wine, the March Hare said in an encouraging tone. Alice looked around the table, but there was nothing on it but tea. I don't see any wine, she remarked. Ah. There isn't any, said the March Hare. Then it wasn't very civil of you to offer it, said Alice angrily. And to some extent, that's what an article is that reports data, but yet doesn't make it available. So as someone suffering from the US political system right now, I can assure you that a Mad Tea Party is not a place to be. And to escape this party, a few years ago, a group of activist journal editors in our field, evolutionary biology and ecology, began meeting at our research center and other like-minded research centers on a regular basis to discuss the idea of data archiving. And this is kind of what they had in mind. There's a whole host of benefits to archiving data at the time of publication, irrespective of how technologically it's achieved, right? We have direct benefits that come from having that data available for reuse and verification. Their indirect benefits, such as avoiding redundant data collection, the burden of sharing request, data upon request. There's near-term benefits. There's long-term benefits, such as preservation and long-term impact of papers long after they've been published. There's private benefits that accrue to those who actually share the data. And then there's those things that are driving much of the news that we hear from funders about the need for greater data management and data transparency, more efficient use of research dollars, greater public trust in science, fewer climate gates, things of that nature. And as a result, after many years of haggling among a number of scientific societies, this group of journals, about 11 of them, came together and adopted a joint data archiving policy. Data are important producers of the scientific enterprise. They should be preserved and usable for decades. As a condition for publication, data supporting the results should be deposited in an appropriate public archive, which left open a long further conversation about what an appropriate public archive is. Authors may elect to embargo access to the data for a period up to a year after publication. This was probably the most contentious and the thing that required the longest amount of negotiation. But it was necessary to include that in order to get buy-in from many of the societies. And exceptions are granted at the discretion of the editor for sensitive information or special cases. The idea is to move the expectation from I will share if there's a really good reason to and I'm compelled to I will share the data unless there's a good reason not to. So just changing the expectation. And it's worth pointing out that the announcement of this policy, which was led by scientific societies, preceded the announcement of any data management plan requirements by NSF. So this was really a grassroots effort. The problem with it is that much of the data does not actually have an appropriate public archive, not in life sciences, and I suspect this is true of many other fields as well. So this nice conceptual diagram for Brian Heidorn shows there's a short shoulder here of data that's easily standardized, for which we have repositories. Many of you are familiar with GenBank and things like that, that are widely used, understood to be valuable. And then there's this long tail of orphan data, where much of the data resides, the kind of spreadsheets of Bumpus's sparrow data. No one's going to collect exactly the same format of data or the same types of data. There's no repository for sparrow bone lengths out there. And this is where much of the valuable data for reuse and validation lives. So in order to have a data archiving policy, the journals came to the conclusion that they required a shared infrastructure, that asking researchers to host data themselves wouldn't be practical or desirable for well-known reasons, that supplemental online materials could work in a pinch, but had some severe drawbacks, which I'll discuss in a moment, and instead what was needed for a digital was a digital repository for orphan data, one that could accept data, whatever the researcher had, in the absence of a discipline-specific standard, even if it's just some crazy spreadsheet organized by a postdoc in some unique way. For the person who's invested in trying to validate the findings in that paper, that idiosyncratic spreadsheet is golden. So it's very easy to be the enemy of the good, for the perfect to be the enemy of the good here, and to want very detailed documentation and data conforming to high standards and so on. But if we insist on that, we'll end up with the situation we're in now, where the data isn't available at all, because researchers, funding agencies, so on, there isn't the effort, there isn't the resources, there isn't the will to produce the grand unified data integration repository of everything. So we can get tremendous mileage just from asking researchers to provide the data they do have in sort of a form of a digital library, where we can access it. We have calling cards for that data, but we don't reach too far into it and expect high levels of curation. And the thing about publication data is that researchers have already generated an extraordinary piece of metadata. They have described the motivation for the study, they described the methodology of data collection, they described how it was processed. You have results in the article that allow you to determine if you're interpreting it correctly. So that's a quite nice piece of metadata to accompany data. If we were to reach down farther and look at the raw data in the lab, the many files that never make it to publication because they're an error, or they didn't lead to anything worthwhile, or they were just pilot experiments, or there's a better image of that cell and under the microscope, they aren't documented, they aren't curated, and basically we're already letting authors curate, select the most important things that need to be preserved, the ones that are most valuable to be reused. The article has been peer-reviewed, so we have a priori reason to think that these are the most valuable data products. So it's a low-hanging fruit to confine data management to this publication-related data sets. So out of these considerations, the shared infrastructure repository for orphan data was born, and that's this Dryad repository. For bioscience data. So to make data archiving and reuse standard part of research and publishing. And the idea behind it was to couple it very closely with the journals. So to enable low burden data archiving at the time of manuscript submission, to promote researcher benefits from data archiving, having these sort of first class research objects well tended, to promote responsible data reuse, to empower the journals and the other parties in shared governance, to ensure sustainability and long-term preservation. This is how the coupling with the journal manuscript submission process works. So we have our scientist here, he's clearly a scientist, he's wearing a suit and tie like they all do, submits his manuscript to the Journal of Paleontology. That journal then, just using regular emails that manuscript processing systems all have, sends information to the author about a record in Dryad that contains all of that manuscript metadata already, because the journal is sending that to the repository. And the journal also sends another form email to Dryad that can be parsed with that information. So that's how that information gets in there. Very low tech. The author then submits the data. For those journals that wish, not all of them do, a review passcode is sent back to them so that they can have anonymous and secure access to the data during review. When and if the article is accepted, then a curator actually looks at it to make sure that just, you know, the metadata is correct, the files aren't corrupted, convert them to preservation formats if necessary, and a DOI for the data is sent back to the journal so that it'll go into the production system and be included in the article. There'll be a permanent link from the article to the data. It's perhaps even more reliable than for many publishers supplementary materials are. And then when the final article comes out, we get the pages and so on and update the bibliographic information within Dryad. So the article is published with its DOI, the data is published with its DOI, and these DOIs from Dryad are minted through the Data Site Agency, which I believe is being talked about in another session right now. Here's an example of one of the template emails that's sent. Blocked out the manuscript number, but this serves as a way for the journal and the repository to communicate about the metadata automatically, just by parsing these processed emails with manuscript reference numbers. If we don't have integration, it can still work, but an author has a higher burden, so they come to the repository to submit their data. They have the responsibility of including the DOI themselves, and hopefully they did it right, but sometimes it doesn't, you know, work when you rely on the author to do it. So here's a comparison of the kind of functions that a repository like this can support relative to supplementary materials. So the data are independently discoverable. They're, one searches for Google Scholar, you'll see data repository records being indexed by groups like Thomson Reuters, and someone may come to the article through the data as well as going to the data through the article. They're identifiable with DOIs, they're permanent and resolvable. There's a preservation strategy in place, unlike, you know, a lab website would have. There's some level of curation from those who are expert in metadata. So again, difficult for scientists to do that themselves. Very easy deposit. One of the mandates we had from the journals early on was that on a typical case, it shouldn't take more than 10 or 15 minutes for data to be uploaded. So the process is very streamlined. The data are ideally formatted for reuse, although that's in the hands of the scientists. They're updatable. So this is something that supplementary online materials rarely do, is that if a scientist comes later and says, oh, there's a mistake or an addition, or I want to add more metadata to make this richer, we can version those at a later date. So it's not exactly a database. It's not something that you'd want to change every day, but the data can live on past the publication. We can support embargoes, so we can delay the release of the data. By default, the data will be released upon the online publication of the article, but the author could elect to do that immediately, or the author can no questions asked ask for 1 year, or the editor can say, well, this is a special case, give this a 3-year embargo. Thanks. Reuse is free, so all the data is released under Creative Commons 0, which puts it in the public domain, so that the terms are clear for reuse, and there's no case by case not sharing that with the graduate student who you don't care about. An economy of scale from a shared infrastructure, which I'll discuss in a second, and you know, this is the mission of the repository. So archiving and reuse of scientific data is a something that publishers sometimes embrace and often don't. Here's an example of one of the article citations. So this is the actual article in PLOS One, and this is the data citation for the data in Dryad. Independent DOI, title derived from the original article, but the journal doesn't appear in the data citation because the policy is if this data is reused, one needs to refer to the article. That's an integral part of the metadata for that data. One also needs above that to actually cite the data. However, the conventions for dealing with data within articles are very scattershot. So here's an example from Science. Supporting online material, you can see where it is on the Science Mag site, what's included, and then in the last of the references in a sort of acknowledgement footnote at the very end, data were deposited at Dryad DOI. So it's there, but an indexer would never find this, right? And so conventions for making this machine understandable across many publishers and journals are very badly needed. So this is a little old, but you can see here, front page of the site, there's data from now over 80-some journals. But only actually about a dozen of them are physically integrated with Dryad, where we actually do that process. So many authors are coming to Dryad voluntarily and going through the more manual, error-prone process. The rate of deposition is increasing greatly. The repository has only been around for a couple of years. We hope to be at a rate of about 10,000 submissions per year within the next 3 years. Surprisingly, the actual sizes of these submissions are rather small, so on average, about 2.5 files per deposit. Most of them are just one file, and most of them are only on the order of 1 to 5 megabytes on average in size. So it's not really a huge storage problem. It's a social engineering problem to get the journals to interact, to get the authors to understand what they need to submit and how. Some authors have taken to using Dryad as the to go into their backlist and recover legacy data from papers that are as much as 10 years old. This group is international in scope, based at a lot of different institutions. There's no single place where they politically would like to put their data, but a third-party repository is something that they can see. So all in one sweep, they deposited all sorts of data on Dryad. And it's being used. This is actually out of date. This is the most downloaded data set we have to date. It's actually been downloaded over 1,000 times because it's being used in all sorts of research and teaching applications. And you know, this is what you see of the data in the paper, but it's actually, for each of these data points, there's stuff there that one can get at through Dryad for reanalysis. So it is being used. And so in conjunction with the journal, a data repository like this is really filling the roles that we expect of a journal to do, of a publisher to do. It's registering the existence of the data. The journal is still responsible for the peer review. Both the journal and the repository have a role in raising awareness. The repository is doing the archiving, and through citations and standard means, authors are getting rewarded for doing that. So maybe I am a publisher after all, right? Because I'm helping run this data repository. And maybe we should think of data sharing not in the context of this altruistic thing that one does, if one has the willingness and the time, but actually as a part of publication. And the data repository allows that to happen. So there's good evidence from the literature for a citation boost for those that actually do provide good reusable data sets for others to build upon and cite. So in this example from Heather Pavovar, of the papers that describe these cancer microarray clinical trials, about 50% had publicly available data, and those 50% received 85% of the article citations. It's independent of journal impact factor, publication date, national origin of the authors, et cetera. So I love this quote from Jeff Bilder from Crossref. Puzzled by the false dichotomy of carrots and sticks, surely the solution is carrot sticks. And a publication is the carrot stick, right? There's incentive, there's sticks and carrots being applied simultaneously, and they're all rolled up in the researcher's mind. There's also incentives for journals in that if one looks at data policies across journals, those that have the highest impact factors, also the ones that have the highest, the strongest data citation policies. So which is cause and which is effect is difficult to disentangle, but there's clearly an ability for journals that have high impact factors to mind research integrity of their articles more. So the value proposition for researchers, I don't think I have time to walk through this, but there's clearly value proposition for researchers, for journals, publishers, and societies, and for funders. And just a word about the business model. So long-term preservation requires a long-term organization. And in Dryad's case, it's in the process of transitioning from grant funding to a membership-based nonprofit, where the revenue is recovered from a very broad beret of customers. Those would be journals and societies and publishers and funders. So it's based on the idea that deposit charges can be paid up front to ensure free access to the data in perpetuity, sort of an open access model for data, which, as you'll see, works fairly well given the cost. And it allows the revenue to scale naturally with the costs and distributes those costs among stakeholders. And the membership basically is responsible for advising, electing the governance board, and is really a community of practice. A lot of the journals have come a long way in their understanding of what their own policies should be regarding data by conversations with each other through the deliberations over how Dryad should be run. So moderate economies of scale are required, but if we achieve those, then we can get the costs for deposit down to around $50 per data set. which compares very favorably with the charges that are being invented for supplementary online materials at other journals. So $300 for Journal of Clinical Investigation. FASEB's the least inexpensive I know of. It's $100 per file. So I think it's a relative bargain. There are a number of payment plans. A journal can subscribe whole hog, and then any paper in that journal is entitled to deposition. Publishers can purchase vouchers in advance or as things are deposited. And alternatively, a publisher can just integrate submission and then expect it of the author to pay for it. I don't believe uptake is going to be very high with that, but it's an option if a publisher needs to go that route for financial reasons. And members would get a discount for this. So just to finish up, the return on investment from this, it's difficult. A rigorous framework is lacking for knowing what that is. But the marginal cost of data archiving is really only about 2% or less of publication costs for most journals, where a print and online article generally costs $2,500 or more by most estimates that I've seen. And it's actually an amazing return given the number of grant dollars that are invested for each article that's recovered. So from NSF and NIH figures, it's about $25,000 per article that they produce. This is 0.2% of that cost. So is the data worth 2% of the research investment of the science that's in the article? I think it's a reasonable supposition that it is, but one can actually look at some cases to see whether that's the case. So in this particular repository for microarray data, there were 2,700 submissions in this year. We look at the data reused by third parties. It contributed, the data itself were a major contributor to over 1,000 articles in that time. So that's hopefully greater than 2% of the recovery on the investment in those articles. So to conclude, I'd like to see data treated as with the same respect and with the same social contract as the content of the article. I think this invention is one that we can easily move over to the world of data if we have relatively simple technological infrastructure, kind of supplemental material on steroids that as publishers we agree to share, this could be achieved. So opportunity for more information for the repository, and I'd like to thank in particular Mike Whitlock, who's the driving force behind the data archiving policy, Heather Provovar, the postdoc I mentioned, who had done a lot of the research on the socio-cultural aspects of data sharing. Thanks.
Many thanks for that, Paul.
Thanks.
Sorry. Very good to see some real cost data in the end of things, because as publishers, we're used to people telling us a lot about how we should be dealing with deposition of data with no idea of where any money is going to come from for curation or anything like that. We've time possibly for one or two questions, and if there's more time at the end, we'll have some more questions at the end. Yeah, there's one. Where is that diamond?
Hi, Diane Scott from the American Association for Cancer Research. How do you deal with executable files, and especially those where there's proprietary software involved? And let's just say an author comes to you with permission from the publisher, and they're giving all of their data to you. Do you give them other sorts of public databases that we require people to put their data in, like microarray data or something like that? You then deposit that to the other databases with their permission?
Well, I guess there's two ways to approach that. To answer the second question first, we see ourselves as sort of the orphan data repository. So if a specialized repository exists, then that data belongs there. And it's up to the journal to make that determination of what repositories are appropriate. So we certainly wouldn't supersede, say, GenBank, right? We've also worked to handshake with some repositories, so like NCBI, some others that are used by our journals, so that the initial file comes to us and we save that file, and then we start the deposition process with that external repository. The advantage to them is that we have very good bibliographic data, which they sometimes often lack, and we can kind of see the deposition process for the author, so it makes it easy for them. So we try to work with them, but we don't try to be redundant with resources that are already out there.
The handshake would be really nice, I think, for authors. And one final question is about timing. I was recently surprised by a publications committee meeting where, you know, many of us have the policy that, you know, it's required for the author to share the data upon request, and then we serve as the middle people to go get it if it's not supplied, and we do that. But when we were looking at our policy and trying to find ways to tighten it up, we were hearing from some of the people around the table about the timing. One was an epidemiologist that said, I, you know, had went through all this to get the funding, and I have this huge pool of data, and it's going to take me a long time to get all the pieces out there, so I don't really want to give my whole, you know, my whole future to somebody requesting this, and as the policies are currently written, she would really have to. So is 3 years a reasonable amount of time for some of the really big research projects? I suspect it depends on the field. But some of these things are, as we're trying to tighten up our policies and make data available, which is what we are all about, at least in scientific societies, then some of these details will have to be flushed out. So I really thank you for a great presentation.
Sure. Just to address the timing issue, so Heather Pavovar's looked in detail at this gene expression omnibus data for clinical microarray for cancer trials. So this is very elaborate, rich data that could be mined for a long time. Looking at the citations of that data, whether they come from a group in which the original authors are included, or the third parties alone are part of the author list. And there's an incredibly steep decline in self-use of the data. After 2 years, almost all the use is by third parties. So people have a perception that they're going to mine this stuff forever, but in truth, a lot of it is published at the time that, you know, that graduate student graduates, and they don't really go back to it. So you're paying the cost of not having it available to the rest of the research community, and you're not really gaining a whole lot of private benefit.
Okay, thanks, Diane, for your question, and thanks, Todd, for that. Can you thank Todd, and we'll ask Max to come up.